I first met Dennis Potter in 1957 when we were Oxford undergraduates. At that time, he was an impassioned socialist, a fine debater, and already a potentially great writer. He began his career as a BBC trainee, working on Panorama. And then he went to the Daily Herald and wrote features. Unsurprisingly, he stood as a Labour candidate in the 1964 general election, and after that, wrote his first television play. Tonight, you are about to see a new production of one of the earliest Potter plays. Message for Posterity was written in 1967 and transmitted as part of the Wednesday play series, but no recording of the original exists. It's a more naturalistic play than Potter's later works, and more obviously political. It's about a radical artist who is commissioned by Parliament to paint a portrait of a Conservative, Sir David Browning, who's twice been Prime Minister. It has echoes of the controversial portrait of Winston Churchill by Graham Sutherland. Writers of the Wednesday play had the opportunity of an access to a large section of the viewing public. And the likes of Dennis Potter and David Mercer in their plays really did seem to sum up the state of the nation. Of course, it's important to remember that Potter's legacy is not just masterpieces like The Singing Detective and Pennies from Heaven, but also contains over 30 original works. It is as a tribute to his unique contribution to the evolution of television that performance gives a new presentation of his 1967 play. Here is Message for Posterity by Dennis Potter.
Now look here. The way you are harrying and hurrying us along, it's positively indecent.
And blasted impertinent.
Let me reiterate. We have been chosen as a select all-party committee by the House to decide upon the most appropriate form of tribute we can pay to Sir David Browning upon his retirement.
And we have. Or haven't we? I can never be sure. We have, so far as I can make out, agreed. Or tentatively agreed. At least I think so. On a portrait.
Not a statue, anyway. Certainly not another bloody statue. Great lump of stone.
Yes, but after all, Sir David was Prime Minister twice. 50 years a member of this House, and 30 years the leader of my party.
He was a great man, certainly. Nobody doubts it.
Is a great man.
There's no need to use the past tense, you know.
Was, is. It was your party, you Tories, that chucked him out. What are we supposed to do now? Bind up his wounds?
I don't want us to fob a great man off with something like a gold watch. That's all I'm saying. He's not a railway porter, you know.
What have you got against railway porters? I'll have you know, I used to be a railway porter.
Oh, for God's sake!
There's nothing wrong with a portrait, is there? A nice portrait?
A portrait in oils, there's nothing wrong with that. Surely not.
No, I suppose not.
All right, then. To sum up.
A portrait in oils.
Precisely. We are agreed.
A large portrait.
Of course.
In a beautiful golden frame. Cheap.
So we are agreed.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, all we have to do is decide upon the artist.
The artist? Well, of course. The chap who actually does the thing.
Oh, Lord. I suggest we each make a suggestion.
Munnings!
He's dead, isn't he?
What?
Passed on, mate, we think.
Munnings dead?
Yes, I'm afraid so.
It might still be the ideal solution. After all, Sir David himself is not exactly what you would call alive and kicking, is he?
Shame.
Oh, joke. A joke. All right, let's think of some other names. Anybody got any suggestions?
What about... this is only a suggestion, mind. What about,
What was the name of the chap who did the Queen? Italian?
Oh, yes, yes.
Italian, you say?
Something like Annie Laurie.
Italian?
I have little doubt myself that we ought to commission a British artist for someone as British as Sir David. I would not be inclined, speaking personally, to risk offering spaghetti to a bulldog.
Well, I'm with you there anyway.
Can't anybody make a suggestion? I mean, good Lord.
Got it. Just the man. James Player.
Who?
James Player. Yes, of course.
Player? Oh, Player. Oh, yes.
Certainly, we've all heard of him, haven't we?
James Player. Hmm.
Rings a bell.
Wait a minute, though. Isn't he... Didn't I once read somewhere? Isn't he a bit of a red?
Oh, I don't know. Radical, yes. But he must be a very old man now.
Most artists, if I may say so. Most artists are a bit, I wish to say nothing controversial, but they do tend to be a bit left of center, you know.
It seems a great pity to me. Sir David will have to sit for the fella. It's a very personal thing.
Look, if you keep raising objections, we shall
have... That's what I say. Look at the bloody time.
I'd like to know a little more about this James Player. I mean, what's he like? What sort of chap is he?
I am doing it because I badly need the cash, dear boy. The loot, my son.
May we quote you on that, Mr. Player?
No, you may not.
Oh, mayn't he, Gillian?
No, he may not. Try and be a little bit more discreet, James.
How many times in how many places has some cool, sensible, sterile voice commanded me to be discreet? Discreet.
Sensible, then.
Discreet. Have you noticed, gentlemen? Rhymes with parakeet.
Mr. Player, all your life you've been considered a very controversial figure and a radical. Some would say an extremist, even.
Yes, yes. Mediocrity always moves to the middle.
Well, perhaps so, but...
No, perhaps nothing.
I beg your pardon?
Where are your nerve endings, sonny boy? Hmm? Your sharpest feelings? Your most vulnerable points? Eh? Eh, answer me that.
Well, I...
I'm not in the hard, cold, lifeless middle, sonny. Oh, you only feel at the extremes. At your fingertips, my boy. Your tongue tip in your genitals, Mr. Whatever your bloody name is.
Wind down, Father.
What did you say?
Please don't choke to death, will you? Now, would you care for some tea, gentlemen?
Not for me, thanks.
Thank you all the same.
You were talking about my politics, weren't you?
Well, in a way, sir, yes. I was wondering whether you felt it at all odd that you, sir, as a famous or even notorious modernist and radical. Well, whether you were at all anxious about doing the portrait of a statesman who is not...
Who is not renowned for his charity, or even his comprehension of the causes I have always so eloquently espoused.
Precisely.
You see, Mr. Player, a lot of people are surprised at this House of Commons decision.
Oh?
And most people are surprised that you have agreed to accept this commission, Mr. Player.
Why?
Why?
Yes, why?
Because on the face of it, sir, you would appear to have almost nothing in common with such a splendidly crusty old reactionary as Sir David Browning.
Precisely.
You keep saying precisely, don't you? Presumably under the illusion it gives an air of exactitude to your dreary waffle.
Well, really, sir, I don't...
Okay, okay, it's a fair question. Fair question.
Well, would you care to answer it, Mr. Player? The question, sir.
Let me see. I'd say it, I guess you were born in the war.
Well, yes.
Dropped prematurely in some crowded air shelter, perhaps. Definitely somewhere lacking a proper air supply.
I say, now look here.
Yeah, inadequate oxygen, undoubtedly. Your brain, therefore, lacked proper nourishment at the crucial time.
Father.
Unlike you, Sir David Browning and myself are both old men. Old, old men. Now, old men have differences of opinion, naturally, but their age, their approaching senility, their redundant lusts and slack loins, their suffocating memories and their vanity, their vanity. Their overwhelming, defenseless, pathetic, bore-rotting vanity, gentlemen, unites them and condemns them. Like comrades in the trenches.
But surely you cannot easily bring yourself to admire the man whose portrait you're to paint. You've always been on opposite sides of the barricades.
Be careful, Father.
Be careful, Father. Dear great God! I've suddenly, at my time of life, got to mutate myself into some sort of mewling and puking diplomat. Have either of you got a cigarette, eh?
You know what the doctor said.
Damn and blast the bloody stinking bastard of a doctor!
I think perhaps we should be making tracks.
Are you going to give me a cigarette, aren't you?
If you really want one.
Gentlemen, I know what you're driving at. Oh, it's not surprising, really. And I can appreciate it would make splendid copy, but you're barking up the wrong tree. Honestly, you are. Cool as the mountain stream. All art is a struggle. And they can't expect you to understand that. All art is a struggle with nameless and unnameless demons. I read that somewhere in one of the posh papers, sitting on a lavatory in Liverpool Street. Oh, critics are cretinous, you know that? It's a damn fine cigarette. Extremely grateful.
I think there's some scotch here. Perhaps you'd rather have that.
Painting the portrait of a dope of a prime minister is no different from painting a fat blue bottle on a scrap of rotting meat. The important thing is to attack. You have to be able to see properly, to get at the truth, if you like.
That should be something.
What should be something?
The truth about Sir David Browning. That should be quite something.
There are skeins of camouflage and habit which protect all the things I want to force onto the canvas.
He's talking about the difference between rape and the casual enjoyment of a prostitute.
Why don't you shut up?
You mean you want to paint Sir David the man, not Sir David the statesman?
Precisely.
You'll need very sharp eyes.
Sharp eyes I have. That's all I have.
Oh, don't be so melodramatic.
No, apologies. I also have a cigarette.
Sir David has had 50 years of public life to protect himself from eyes that are too sharp, Mr. Player.
He's cunning, too. Very cunning.
Someone once said that even his comments about the weather were elaborate facades designed to obscure the real movements and passions of his mind.
Oh, you don't say. But if the withered folds of skin which submerge his little pale eyes are the colour of putty, then putty-coloured they shall be.
That all sounds very alarming for poor Sir David.
Sir David is undoubtedly aware of my work and my reputation and my relentless honesty. It's only to be expected he should feel a few twinges of alarm.
What were you saying about the vanity of old men?
I'll get stuffed, my dear.
Ho, ho, ho. You're a bloody menace, that's what you are.
Thank you, Ma.
I think we'd better leave.
Yes, so do I.
I'm sorry.
You could leave me another cigarette if you like. And in return, I'll give you a very apt quotation.
Well, gladly, but if, as your daughter says, the doctor...
No, give him one. The poor old fool will probably start blubbering if you don't.
Oh, what a nasty little bitch you are.
What's the quotation, Mr. Blair?
Old men forget.
Quote, the painter is lord of all types of people and of all things.
And is more often than not a megalomaniac.
If he wishes to see beauties that charm him, it lies in his power to create them. And if he wishes to see monstrosities that are frightful, buffoonish, ridiculous, or pitiable, he can be lord and creator thereof. Leonardo da Vinci.
The same can be said of journalists, too.
I'm beginning to feel rather sorry for our former Prime Minister.
That's not. You should feel sorry for.
Rock-a-bye, baby, on the treetop. When the wind blows, the cradle will rock. When the bow.
Do you think you're doing?
I beg your pardon, Sir David. I didn't mean to wake you, sir.
Like a blasted great herd of wild elephants stamping about the place.
Very sorry, sir.
Furthermore, I will thank you to keep your observations to your clumsy self.
Sir?
They're entirely inaccurate.
I am very sorry, sir.
He's not asleep.
No, sir.
I was contemplating something of great importance when you disturbed me with your clumsiness.
Yes, sir. I beg your pardon, sir.
You sleep indeed. Barnes, is it time for the black and white minstrel show?
No, I'm afraid not, sir. That was last night.
Isn't it on every night, then?
No, sir. Once a week only, sir.
Lend me a gray mare.
All along down the lonely.
For I wanna go to Winnicott Fair.
With a will and
can steward.
Be a Gary.
Be a Davy.
Down the wind.
Harry Hawk.
Hold up, go down the
The squalid tactics of totalitarian ruffians. The policy of terror and blackmail. The thick black stain of a vicious ideology which has seeped over the disfigured map of Europe. But I tell you this now, and I tell you without bravado, that we will prise that grip away, finger by finger, joint by joint, by day and by night, by courage and by cunning, by diligence and endurance, until that bright dawn will come when the peoples tortured continent will open their eyes once more, a world cleansed of the Nazi plague.
Cleanse of the Nazi plague! Cleanse of the Nazi plague!
Where's my blasted cup gone? Come on. I hope they sing Roses of Picardy for a change.
And he said the motorists who disregarded the motorway's warning notices should be banned for at least 6 months.
Definitely.
Mr. James Player, chosen earlier today by the Special Committee of the House of Commons to paint Sir David Browning's portrait, denied in an interview this afternoon that the much-publicized political differences between the artist and his sitter would create any special difficulties. Mr. Player, well known for almost 40 years as a controversialist as well as a great artist, said that so far as he was concerned, a painting was a struggle to see the truth, whether it be of a former prime minister, or a blue bottle, or a piece of rotting meat.
And that's all from us until 10 minutes past 11.
Hawkins! Where in hell and damnation is Hawkins? Hawkins! The smile cannot have been altogether lost on even the most obtuse. Blue bottle. The word just buzzed into my mind at exactly the right moment. Blue bottle. And you know, don't you, that he sent the troops into the Welsh valleys to break up a miners' strike? The fascist swine. Tramp, 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 tramp. Bayonets gleaming. Silent men watching. Watching. Little shivering groups, Jillian. Blue coal scars. Tipped like trademarks into the bridges of their noses. You know, I had begun to think that perhaps my best work, my most significant, challenging, politically committed achievements were all lying dead and gasping like stranded lizards on the high road behind me. Well, that I was, in a sense, redundant, Jillian. Redundant. Burned out, even. It's a very black, very terrible feeling. A gangrenous affliction, Jillian. Shall I put the light on?
No.
I'm going to put the light on.
No!
But you're not the only one to suffer. I get bad headaches too, I hope you realize. Very bad. But they do not cause me to withdraw into sullen and graceless self-pity.
Be quiet, please.
No, I won't. You might plunge me into darkness, my girl, but I'll be damned if you'll still my tongue. What did that Fleet Street gutter snipe say? The older one. The one with just a hint, the merest hint of intelligence flickering hopefully behind his pudding face. Something about Browning using even his after-dinner remarks to hide the real movements and whatnots of his mind. His mind? Yes, he has a mind of sorts, I suppose. At least he's capable of great cunning. Well, then all the leaders of his party, pestilential crew, have great cunning. Well, stands to reason they must have to persuade people to put them in power all those years. Cunning, yes. Sheer brute animal cunning. All this, of course, will be discernible in my portrait. Like a final judgment. A long-postponed moment of reckoning. The just revenge of a long-abused people. I do not like sitting in the dark. It's not right that I should sit in the dark. Shall I put the light on? Hey, Gillian? Shall we have some light in this coffin?
You make me sick.
Please, talk to me, Gillian! I know you have a headache. I don't mind about the light. I'll have another cigarette, you know. You'll be able to see the end of my cigarette glowing red, Gillian. It's all your fault, you heartless bitch. You'll be able to see it burning. You'll see it through the weave of that flannel.
Impertinence is breathtaking, Hawkins.
I do assure you, Sir David, that the only direct comparison being made was, so to speak, a technical one. About painting as such, rather than a personal one.
Didn't sound like it to me.
But I don't.
I tell you, Hawkins, the news reader or newscaster or whatever they call the damn thing was grinning.
Well.
Grinning, Hawkins, almost licking his chops.
They tend to be like that, I rather think. Frustrated Robin Day, so I'm led to believe.
Pleasant enough chap, that. As long as the light doesn't flash on his spectacles. I always like to see their eyes, Hawkins. Always look at their eyes.
Quite.
Would you care to join me in a little drink, Hawkins?
Thank you, Sir David. It would be a pleasure.
I always used to consider this by far the most pleasant part of my day, Hawkins.
Oh, indeed. The ploughman homeward plods his weary way.
What's that?
The ploughman, you know, sir, Gray's Elegy.
Oh, poetry.
Ah, yes. A beautiful poem, don't you think?
Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water.
Yes, Sir David, one cannot better the simple rhythms learnt at the knee.
Jill came down with half a crown, and it wasn't for carrying water. You must learn, Hawkins, not to be pompous. I suppose we can expect a visit from this player fellow in the near future.
Yes. We have exchanged letters, Sir David. It should not create too much inconvenience.
You mean it will help to pass the time?
No problem in that department. Anyway, there are, of course, your memoirs, Sir David. A most exciting prospect.
You really think so?
Naturally, sir.
Hawkins, you are deluded.
I beg your pardon?
I'm an old steed, broken in wind, that has been put out to grass.
Nobody in the party, or at least no one who matters, wanted you to resign the leadership, Sir David. I'm convinced of that.
Then you are a congenital idiot, Hawkins.
Perhaps some of the younger so-called activists or whiz kids thought it necessary that you should die.
Leave my elderly carcass out of their way. Of course they did.
Oh, I wouldn't go so far as to say that, Sir David.
No, Hawkins. You wouldn't.
Certainly not, sir.
Ingratitude is the one recurring theme in British politics. Look at what happened to poor old Winston in 1945. Look at what's happening to me in 1967. Ingratitude. Base. Black ingratitude. This is the age of the little man, Hawkins. The little man. Have you heard the conversations of the astronauts in their space capsules? Have you heard? Thousands of miles up, way above the spinning Earth, poised like gleaming angels, Hawkins. And they chew gum. They
they chew gum. Good Lord, we abuse our minds, we abuse our language, we abuse our faith. Men, I say, with dumb-colored minds, words like exhalate on their lips, principles formed according to gallop. Tradition is treated like a cheap bauble to hang on a synthetic silvery Christmas tree, something you can smash into fragments at any moment with no more thought than... I'm sick of it, Hawkins. Sick of it. Sick to the marrow of my bones. An old blue bottle, you see, buzzing impotently on the scrap heap.
Would you care to see some television, Sir David? I think it's Danger Man in about 10 minutes' time. You're very fond of the program, aren't you, Sir David?
Don't say you're nervous, James, after all you've been saying.
Nervous? What about? What are you talking about, woman?
Nervous? About meeting Brownie?
Don't be so bloody silly. Why on earth should I be nervous about meeting a half-dead old warhorse?
Well, you are.
What are you yapping about? If I'm nervous at all, if, I say if, and it's because of the abominable way in which you propel this car.
You mean drive, don't you, dear?
Miss Drive.
Ha!
Our tyres are almost as smooth as billiard balls. You know that. It's very easy to skid out of control on roads like this. Oh, slow down, girl, for God's sake. Skid there too early, anyway.
Well, that's your problem.
The first meetings are always such gigantic bores, aren't they? I shall have to negotiate and parley my way through a whole smelly litter of butlers and footmen and chambermaids and private secretaries.
I'm going up in the world, aren't you?
Yes, my darling daughter.
It'd be completely illogical of you to refuse a knighthood after all this. You'll probably get lots more commissions, James. The aristocracy, bankers, Lord Mayor of London, the 1922 committee, the corn hunt, Bernard Levin. You never know. The Munnings de Nogeor.
I suppose you saw that nasty little piece in the New Statesman, did you?
I wondered when you were going to mention it.
I suppose it is an illusion, Richard.
What is, Father?
An illusion that the summers of one's youth were always golden. Always shimmering with perfectibility. Even the benches in the House of Commons seem to get sticky with the heat. My backside's never warm these days.
Yes, Father. But it is an illusion, at least as far as the meteorological records are concerned.
An illusion.
According to the facts and figures.
Facts and figures? You cannot measure memory with such devices, Richard.
No, I suppose not.
Hot summer days, Chelsea buns on the riverbank, eh?
Yes, Father. Somewhat damp, though, I suspect.
Big red sun in a blue sky, and the Pax Britannica, eh?
Upon which the sun has set.
Must stand by our own kith and kin, Richard.
Like who, for instance, Papa?
Like your great aunt Maud, Richard. Crippled with arthritis.
She's dead, Father.
I last saw your aunt in the Lord Belgrave in Whitcomb Street. No. No. The Alhambra. Bobby Howes, was it?
I beg your pardon.
I've got a date with an angel, and I'm on my way to heaven. No one else could be sweeter. She looks divine when I meet her. I'll be as proud as St. Peter.
Ah, good old song. Hey, Father?
They don't make them the same anymore. Nothing's the same.
Nothing. It's true. Not a fair wage for a fair day's work. Not the immutability of the laws of supply and demand. Not honor among Tories.
If you like, Father.
Well, doesn't look as though you'll be able to take your walk this morning, does it?
Blast the rain. Quite an auspicious morning for Mr. Player's first visit. Alarming fellow, by all accounts.
A Bolshevik.
But a great artist.
Nowadays, they can hang a lavatory seat in the Tate and label it great art. The committee must have been mad.
Or just plain ignorant, Father, which is more likely to be the case. Player is probably the only artist they knew by name now that Munnings is dead.
Oh, they knew what they were doing, all right.
How do you mean?
Can't you see that it's obvious? Obvious. A deliberate and vicious, squalid attempt to belittle me. Shrink my stature. Mock my achievements. The old must not only give way to the new, but must be derided and spat at in the process. A conspiracy, that's what it is, Richard. An evil and ruthless conspiracy.
I should have a little sleep if I were you, Father.
It might clear up, please, sir.
Admirers of James Player, a demanding band, it seems, are bound to be a little anxious about the once fiery artist's acceptance of the Commons commission to paint Browning's portrait. Strange to see the former pacifist apparently adding to the deification process which usually embalms our elder statesmen. But sad to say, James Player's erstwhile genius has for long shown signs of solidifying into mere formalism and nostalgic pedantry. The arteries of genius have hardened.
Don't worry about it.
It's Wizard Gillian, a dead map of a hand. What's the matter?
What's the matter?
The cops.
What?
The police! Don't say a word. Let me handle this.
I damn well told you to slow down.
Will you just shut up? Good morning, officer.
Good morning, madam. Are you aware that you were travelling at least 60 miles an hour when in the 30 speed limit?
Oh, no, I don't think so.
Most definitely not.
Yes, you were. Can I see your driver's licence, please, and your certificate of insurance?
Who do you think you are, Himmler?
Be quiet, Father, please.
Your driver's licence, please.
Yes, of course, officer. Do try not to hold us up for too long, won't you?
Busy people, are you?
Very busy.
Yes, we're on important House of Commons business.
House of Commons? How do you mean exactly, madam?
Well, we're on our way to Eastreps, the country home of Sir David Browning.
Sir David Browning?
That is so, officer. I am taking my father, Mr. James Player, O.M., for the first sitting of the portrait requested by Her Majesty in the Commons.
Oh, I see, ma'am.
What's your name, officer?
Jenkins, ma'am. I'm sorry you were delayed. Obviously, you want to get to Eastreps as quickly as possible.
Obviously.
Yes, well, the weather, you know, I mean, we're a little bit behind schedule.
Well, if we can be of any assistance.
Assistance?
Yes, sir. We will escort you to Eastreps.
No, no.
Oh, that would be very kind and thoughtful of you, officer. Thank you.
Right then, madam. We will lead the way.
My God. My God.
You sent for me, Mr. Browning.
Yes. I'm sorry to bother you. My father. How is he?
As well as can be expected, I think.
Walks very slowly.
As though looking for lost coins.
My father's very old, Hawkins.
I try to see that Sir David is not overburdened.
Thank you. It's very proper. I wasn't quite talking about his physical well-being, Hawkins.
No, sir.
Come, you must know very well what I mean.
Yes.
Well,
I would say that the manner in which he was, as it were, forced to relinquish the leadership has understandably left Sir David feeling very bitter, especially as it followed so brutally upon electoral defeat and the barrage of criticism in the press.
He's never really been the same man since the death of my mother.
No, sir. Quite. That is also my impression.
But he is a very remarkable man, Hawkins.
Oh, indeed. Yes, of course.
We mustn't allow his reputation to be sullied by...
By an indiscretion or intemperate remark.
Exactly. I'm glad you understand me so clearly.
I shall do my best, of course. But,
Yes?
I'm a little worried about this portrait business. Player has not previously been noted for his discretion, according to what one hears. I wonder if we could get him to sign the Official Secrets Act.
Splendid idea. Yes. Oh, definitely, yes. Can't have a man like that blabbing about my father's paranoia.
Your father's what, sir?
Now, you're a very good actor, Hawkins. I said, and I meant, paranoia, old chap. Onset of senility, I suppose. We can only dare hope that this blasted player fellow is similarly afflicted.
Wouldn't people smile if they could witness such a humiliation?
Oh, don't go on about it, sir.
Escorted by the cops.
Where's your sense of humor, James?
The death of a radical.
We must cleanse Europe of the aggressor.
We must build a land fit for heroes.
Who the hell are you?
Good afternoon, sir. I'm sorry if I startled you. My name is Player.
James Player? Player?
A painter, sir?
Ah, yes, a painter. In the hush of the silvery dew.
I beg your pardon?
You interrupted an unscheduled doze, Mr. Player.
I'm sorry, sir. A man called Hawkins told me to come out.
Hawkins did?
Yes, sir. He obviously thinks our first meeting should be as informal as possible. Despite the fact that he made me sign something called the Official Secrets Act.
Ah, the divine mysteries, Mr. Player. Would you care to sit down for a while?
Thank you, sir.
It's always pleasant after summer rain, don't you think? Everything looks and smells so much sweeter.
Even the Official Secrets Act.
this is not altogether unlike a visit to the dentist.
Oh, no, sir. I assure you it will all be utterly painless. For you, at least, Sir David.
I profoundly hope so, Mr. Player. No elongated arms or cube-shaped heads.
No, sir.
No big red eye in the middle of my forehead?
No, sir.
And definitely not any holes in the middle of my body.
Definitely not.
Am I being offensive to you, Mr. Player?
Indeed you are, Sir David.
Good. I do not like being compared to a blue bottle.
A terrible misquotation, that. We have the most prostituted press in the world.
Nye.
What?
The press. Nye Bevan said that. Squalid nuisance.
He was the greatest politician since Lloyd George. Nye was a very great, very, very great man indeed.
I was referring to blue bottles. Flies. Flies?
Oh,
complete misunderstanding.
The walrus and the carpenter.
Well, at least the first meeting seems to be a placid enough affair.
What were you expecting, Daddy? A punch-up?
Your whole manner, Clara, shows disrespect towards your grandfather. What have you come here for?
Money, sweetie.
And you can go away again.
Oh, darling. Ogre.
How did you know I was visiting Eastrips today?
I love this sun lounge. I mean, it's so sort of nostalgic. Way out.
Nostalgic?
Gilt mirrors and wicker chairs and spider's webs and a lawn outside. Anyone for tennis? Stroking moustache? Everything.
Tell me something better.
I like it. I said I like it, honestly. It's impossible.
I feel a bit uncomfortable here, to tell you the truth.
Oh, no, not uncomfortable. It's quaint. Like a film set. 78 RPM.
I'm not so far away from all this to be quite so amused, Clara. Now, your generation makes the whole of England seem artificial and decayed and...
Mouldy old wedding cake.
You mustn't let your grandfather hear you say such things, Clara.
You're not kidding, what?
I see, Player, I see. First of all, you just want to talk rather than examine my jawline.
Exactly, Sir David. A painting, after all, is not a photograph.
Oh, mind that bottle. You want, if I understand you correctly, to find the man through his talk. What puddle?
That puddle.
Ah, yes. Many thanks. This garden is fast becoming a blasted obstacle course.
Oh, it's very beautiful here. Quite painfully so.
I'm fond of this place, Player. You can well appreciate that.
Better than a back-to-back in Leeds or the Gorbals. Eh, Sir David?
Poor people, poor people.
I once lived in the slums.
Really? Starving in a garret, no doubt.
Lots of sooty houses.
What's that? endless smoking rows of them, with tiny squares of light for windows, or the flap-flap of washing strung out from a top-floor stairway, blowing in the dust.
Dreadful.
And I used to hear a thing I couldn't bear to hear. Babies crying at the bottom of the stone steps. Trapped like wind in a chimney.
I thought you wanted to listen to me, Blair.
I do, Sir David. And to listen to you listening. Do you follow me?
No, I damn well don't.
Ah.
Besides, who wants dreary, weary talk about the gobbles on a sunny afternoon like this? You've never felt tempted to cut off your ear, have you, Claire?
What?
oh, dear, I was thinking about that all morning and I simply could not resist it.
Well, that's all right, Sir David. I am, in any case, only too pleased to be given these literally quite astonishing glimpses of your reputedly great wit.
England swings like a pendulum do. Bobby's own bicycles two by two. Westminster Abbey, the Tower of Big Ben, the rosy red cheeks of the little children.
Meat off the fallow deer, Player. From the buck, naturally.
Naturally.
Marinated for many hours in olive oil and red wine. Served rare, Player, with a chestnut puree.
Do you eat it bloody, Sir David?
No. Rare, as I said. Rare, old chap. Definitely not bloody.
Not bloody. Stalin was very fond of it, you know. I believe he even ate it out of season. Very totalitarian thing to do, don't you think?
Any slander will do. Any slander.
A great tyrant.
Walled up in the Kremlin now. They embalmed him, and then they spat on him. His statues are pulled down by demolition squads. Women, you know. Big, fat women with hairy lips.
What?
The demolition squads.
Oh.
Thus are the great men of each generation reviled and dishonored by the pygmies who inherit their works. Always happens, always. Ingratitude is universal. Conspiracy knows no frontiers. The old values, the old sense of duty, honor, national purpose. Pah! Miserable little troops of miserable men chatting the downfall of their leaders over lukewarm cups of instant coffee. Fleet Street gossip columnists are the new kingmakers. Sense of responsibility is subverted into a lust for power. Power!
Nasty word, that. Nasty word.
Good day to you, Player.
What's the matter, sir?
I'm weary of this. Good day.
Oh,
Father.
Clara?
I thought it would be nice to come and see you, Grandfather.
What are you doing?
I was dancing, sir. Do you want me to go, Grandfather?
Day to you, player. Good day to you, player. Bloody old fool! Cut off my ear. Chestnut puree. A chestnut puree, you senile old bastard. You sanctimonious, po-faced, piddle-brained fascist. Cut off. Pink and blue veins. All broken. Like an ordnance survey map. On his beady, bird-eyed, anteater snout. Flesh the color of old putty. Pink rims to his little pig eyes. Oh, poor old devil. It's rotting away. Rotting away among the puddles and garden benches and rusty dispatch boxes. My God, I could do with another cigarette.
I have always... and everywhere, in the House of Commons and in the country, endeavored to combat the mind rot and brain canker of socialism, so-called, by reason, and by reason alone. I leave sentimentality and half-truth to my opponents. They have need of it. But the cold logic of facts, ladies and gentlemen, and the precise mustering of statistics can sometimes leave a vacuum in the hearts of men. It is time to appeal to the imagination and inner flame of our people, to their sense of history and quiet, instinctive poetry. What does it mean to be British? Precious little, reply so many, for some even willing to take any half-naked fakir at face value. It is a matter for shame, for embarrassment. To those I would say, look around you, gentlemen. Listen to your fathers. Catch the echoes of your own history, the slow pulse of the past.
Good morning, sir. Some tea? The sun's shining again, sir. A lovely morning. Sir?
I'm prepared to go to Berlin. I'm prepared to go to Tokyo. I will look for peace in the conference room, peace in the chancelleries. But I say now that... A cup of tea?
Yes, sir.
Good. My throat is rather dry. Thank you, Emily.
This morning, I had another talk with the German Chancellor, Herr Hitler. And here is the paper which bears his name upon it as well as mine.
Great mistake. A terrible error.
I beg your pardon, sir.
I said so at the time. What are you doing here? Are the birds still singing?
Yes, sir. Is there anything else you need, sir?
No, no. No, thank you very much, Emily. Just a cup of tea, my dear. Poor old Neville.
I had a bad dream, Gillian, that's why. Chamberlain took off his starched collar trying to strangle me with it. Then all at once he turns into Kipling with metal spectacles.
Oh, how nice. Good job it wasn't metal claws.
It must have been the Stilton.
Perhaps. Or prolonged exposure to a gaga statesman.
Will you pass me the marmalade? Seen the charcoal sketches I've done? Well?
I'm disappointed.
Disappointed?
Oh, they're very skillful, but somehow too rigid, too devoid of life.
So is Browning.
Ah, but to capture that sort of decay, you have to have light of a very special kind in the drawings themselves.
They are only preliminary sketches.
Well, you asked me what I thought.
This portrait, it will be, it must be, brilliant. Eh? An indictment of the whole English establishment. The sag of aging flesh will be, quite clearly, the disintegration of a facade, a sham, Gillian. With nothing behind it, no substance.
There's none of that in the charcoal.
Why don't you shut up?
And don't spread the marmalade all over the cloth.
Bitch. When that face takes shape on the canvas, the criminal morality of his kind will be encapsulated for all time. Just as a popular song carries with it all the overtones of a period. A particular period of time.
Abba dabba dabba dabba, said the monkey to the chimp.
He won't escape me now. By God, he won't. 1926, him the bastard, you'll see.
Cheap music can be so potent. I wish you wouldn't keep asking about my grandfather. I mean, what sort of kick does it give you?
There's nothing specially erotic about it, is there? Well, is there? He's a pretty marvellous old sweetie, really. Honestly, my love, you can't have ancestor worship by proxy. That's for Americans, not you Germans, not us Europeans.
No, no, no. That's not it, my dear Clara. But most, how do you say, Iger ogre? Most ogres stay in the storybook, no?
What?
When I was a boy in Mannheim, Browning was the beast of Britain, you know? My mother used to say to me when I wouldn't go to sleep that Browning and the English would be after me. And to think that now I am...
Now you what?
How would you feel if I was the grandson of Adolf Hitler?
The same as now, Carl.
It's the same.
The same as now. Same as if you were Lord Kitchener's valet. The past is past, Carl. The past is dead. Dead. That's why I get annoyed. Yes, annoyed by all this prying and poking about my grandfather.
No, Clara. Dead, no. Not quite dead. We can still embroider, is that right? You know, make patterns with it. I am sorry I am so prying and poking. I just like to know things. You know, to know things.
I don't know what you're going on about.
One of the guards, the German guards at Auschwitz, took his Staatsexamen, his A-levels, in Goethe and humanism. That is the sort of thing I like to know, Clara.
What?
He was studying for an examination in humanity while working in the gas chamber. How funny is it?
Like Reader's Digest, Kamerad. And it still doesn't explain why you ask so many damn questions about my grandfather.
You English.
Us English.
You don't want to know about anything anymore. You just don't want to know. Whether you are guilty or not. Whether you are maybe...
Do shut up, for goodness sake. And get dressed. Anybody would think Hitler was your granddaddy, the way you talk.
I have no doubt, Claire, that this will be the finest portrait of me that has ever been done. No doubt whatsoever, Claire. Also be your greatest work, Mr. Player, your supreme achievement.
Thank you.
Not at all, not at all. You won't put too many wrinkles in the neck, will you?
Wrinkles, David?
It doesn't matter. Vanity and delusion.
What?
Delusion and vanity.
Don't think you need worry about wrinkles, Sidney.
When and if we eventually reach heaven, Mr. Player, I doubt whether we shall be permanently burdened with the carcasses of incontinent old men. My mother, you know, always used to tell me when I was a fully grown man that whenever she dreamed about me, it was always as a child that she saw me. A little boy with velvet trousers and a sailor's collar. And when I dream about myself now, I invariably appear as I was in my prime.
That would be what? 1926, Sir David?
Give or take a few decades. 1926. Why'd you say 1926?
Oh, I suppose some dates stay in the mind. 1926. General strike. Hunger and humiliation of coal miners. Brink of a British Revolution that should have but didn't happen.
Oh, come, come.
Year of shame.
On the contrary.
A black, black year.
On the contrary, 1926 saw the triumph of common sense and constitutional government.
Oh, nonsense.
Don't you nonsense me, sir.
I don't talk nonsense, sir.
Such outrageous impertinence since...
I saw Arthur Cook, the miners' leader, make a speech on some common ground in the middle of the Forest of Dean. It was pouring with rain, torrential rain. The miners were gathered all round him. Grey faces turned upward. Blue coal scars tipped and curses into the bridges of their noses. A dull glint of pride and worry in their eyes. A silicosis cough breaking up the cadences of that hopeless, vain, glorious speech. And ringed all around, under the dripping, dank trees. Wearing blue capes and carrying thick little truncheons were the police, the bloody police!
The salt of the earth, Blair.
And Cook, who was already a sick man, suddenly flung out his finger and shouted, I don't want you blue bottles following me around.
Blue bottles?
Blue bottles!
Look here, Blair, I've been meaning to tackle you about that.
And at that very moment, a huge fork of lightning jagged down and split an old oak tree clean through the middle.
Good heavens.
Oh, the police looked very furtive. Began to shuffle their big flat feet. It was part of their ideology that God was on their side.
They had a thankless task and they performed it bravely.
Oh, my God!
Sentimentality is no proper guide to correct action in politics or anything else. And impertinence is not an adequate substitute for reason.
Shut up!
What did you say?
Shut up!
Shut up yourself! Quite forgotten to whom I was speaking. The force of memory, you know.
Memory.
Yes, I...
The old man's burden, Player. It's quite all right. I understand. I understand perfectly. Shall we finish this, session now? I'm a little tired.
Of course, Sir David.
May I take a tiny peep at what you're doing? How it is coming?
No, sir, you may not.
Oh?
It's not my custom, sir. I'd find it too difficult, Sir David.
Very well. But I hope the neck muscles are not too slack, my dear fellow. My dear old friend.
Catch the echoes of your own history. The slow pulse of the past.
Another bad night?
An indifferent one. Dreams, dark shapes, cold feet, rain on the windows.
Are you worried about the work?
No. No.
Well, you're usually so energetic when you're working.
No, it's... all coming very well indeed. But it exhausts me. I'm so tired.
Well, we'll go away for a while when you've finished. Shall we?
See, I've never before, never, so completely been so possessed by a painting of mine as I am by this one, Gillian. I know my work had been deteriorating.
You've always denied it, James.
Well, of course I have. How could I admit to anything else? I took this commission on out of sheer bravado and desperation.
And vindictiveness.
Perhaps.
David has a most interesting face. You know, there are things in it, stories in it, you would never, ever begin to imagine. It's been, well, mutated and mutilated by politics, compromise, and fear, and hope, and vanity. He's a most remarkable man. The essence of our time, our situation, riveted on one face.
Don't give over, James. He's just another political bore, drifting into senility.
You mustn't say that, Gillian.
Well, why mustn't I? You said the same thing yourself.
Listen, Gillian.
A bloody old reactionary. That's what he is.
Don't say that, Gillian! Don't say that!
James, what on earth?
Oh, please, Gillian. Please, my dear child. I don't talk about the poor old devil like that.
Father.
It makes everything so empty, Gillian. So pointless.
Mary? Mary? I'm so tired of it all.
Father? Father?
What is it now?
Getting a little chilly out here. You'd better come in.
I can't feel anything. What are you doing here?
I've come down to talk to Hawkins.
Hawkins? Oh, Hawkins. Let us go in, Richard. It's cold out here now.
Yes, Father. The publishers are bringing out a new selection of your speeches. I've been reading some of them again. Now they still seem extraordinarily vivid, relevant. I doubt whether the hot air we hear in the Commons nowadays will last anything like as long.
Let us awake. Let us stir from this perverse lethargy and corpse-like indolence. Awake, I say. The light in this room is awful, Sir David. Abominable!
That is not my responsibility. However, I apologize.
Oh, I must say, it's all coming very well, very well.
Is it, Blair? Is it really? I should very much like the privilege of just a glance, Blair, eh? A quick glance?
No, Sir David.
Very well. Shall we have some scotch, James, eh?
It's a bit early, Sir David.
And you could have a cigarette.
Oh, a very cunning remark, sir. Wicked.
Wasn't it?
Ah, doctors. Greet the scoundrels in the land.
I assume it's a great virtue to keep an old man alive.
I have smoked for 60 years.
Grapefruit for breakfast. That's all. No bacon, Blair, no bacon.
Oh, well, charlatans to a man.
It's so expensive.
You've never been in the public ward of a big hospital, have you?
No, I haven't.
Well, count your blessings, mate.
You really do have an extraordinarily impertinent manner, Blair.
You cannot change overnight the comforting habits of a lifetime.
No. I wouldn't dream of asking you to. At least you are still doing things, my dear fellow. You are not redundant.
Cheer up. Youth, according to this, really, is a blunder. Manhood a struggle, and old age a regret. That's a quotation. I give you another one. Another quotation, I mean. The painter is lord of all types of people and of all things. If he wishes to see beauties that charm him, it lies in his power to create them. And if he wishes to see monstrosities... Yeah. I do so like stimulating conversation. I was told by some deluded fool to expect it in this place. You think you can just sit there, don't you? Hoping that all your past crimes against humanity will simply fade away. Jesus, I do like talking to myself. Always have to talk to myself. Gives me the guts. My God, he's asleep. Just simply nodded off. Well, it won't do. It won't do. Sir David! Oh, come along, old fellow. Wakey, wakey. There's things to do. Sir David, please, Sir David, please! I'm sorry I was impertinent. If I was impertinent. Wake yourself up, you doddering old fool, you hear me? Worse than talking to Gillian. Eh, she hates me like poison. Bah, that is not me in particular, just men. Men, you see. It's a face, you understand. Post-coital sadness. As I had it at the time. A gypsy woman someplace in Hertfordshire. Don't go and die. Not yet. There's a good chap. I assure you the portrait's going very well. I haven't put in all that scrag of loose putty either. Oh, come on now. Have to be so vindictive, do you? You were all right a moment ago. I don't understand it. How can I possibly work in such condition? I'm 1926, you bastard! Keep calm. Remain objective. Do it. Keep doing it. With the gentle, precise detachment of a botanist recording the foliage
of an extinct plant. For posterity, James.
Before you seek things to destroy, look to that which must be preserved. Before you cut off the limb, see if a bandage or a crutch will do. Before you mock, think with reverence. Before you appeal in grand and bloody words to the so-called inevitability of history, make sure you know what history is and who it is about. Have we so little regard for the strife of our forefathers that we can so eagerly, in such a headlong hurly-burly, discard that which we know to be true?
It won't be long now, as long as you keep quiet.
Excuse me, gentlemen, but Clara has called, said... Good God. What's happened? What in the name of God are you doing?
Will you be quiet? I'm trying to finish.
Mad. Sir David. All right. It's all right.
Help me, Player.
Come here, Player. Help me, Player. Clara! Player! Clara! Clara! David, it's all right. Clara!
I thought it. I said I would. What is it?
I think he's dead. Player!
Never mind him. Keep calm. Let me try.
Mary?
Don't worry, sir. You'll be all right. You'll be all right.
Talk about queers, Bill.
He's my very best friend.
Shut up, you blubbering fool!
Poor old devil.
I'll ring for an ambulance. And the police.
Be quick.
Oh, he's going to die, isn't he? Poor old man. At least I hope he's going to die. He deserves to.
Trembling to death by a herd of wild animals. Like a bloody thousand. Oh, yes, he deserves to. As do most politicians, degenerate creatures. Tampering with the world. Like a child playing with the contents of his potty.
Can you tell me what happened?
Happened with?
It doesn't matter.
Nothing happened! Nothing, you hear me?
Oh?
Ah, the old fool simply fell asleep while I was talking to him. It's a familiar protective device. His breed never listens. He shut his mind years ago, so why get the bloody tits when he shuts his eyes as well? Look at this room for a start. Look at this bloody awful room! Mausoleum. What am I doing here? I don't know what I'm doing here. I'm not an exhibit. This is the worst place, including prisons, including brothels I've ever been in. Ah, the pigsty! A baroque pigsty! Built out of empire! And there's the big fat sow sprawled on the looted carpet.
Don't come near him!
I'll kick him in his testicles if he had any hair.
Get away!
Ah, put the boot in! Kick him while he's down! This is the moment I've been waiting for all my life!
Red scum!
Just look at this room. The Victoria and Albert! Yes! Rubbish, most of it. Junk! From all over the world. The plunder of tasteless district commissioners and ignorant brigadiers. They kill a mighty beast to make toothpicks and presents for shriveled maid nuts. You should say that. At the precise moment I've come to my senses. Oh, a little slum clearance is the best possible prelude for rebuilding. smash it up. Smash it all up. Loot from India. Litter from put a match to their Chinese carpet. Oh, and fracture their ivory ornaments. What they do to us? They break us up. They stomp on us. Loot from our labor. All a fraud, all a cheat. Oh, out through the window with it.
My property.
Come in, gentlemen, come in. I have never had more lucid in my whole life. Action! Clayton!
I knew something or other was bound to happen. I'd been feeling so tired, so worn out.
Yes, Father, all this wretched portrait business is far too much of a strain for you.
I think you're looking absolutely super now, Grandpa.
Indeed you are, sir.
Now, I mustn't all talk at once. Father must be rather weary.
No, no, not now. Thanks to you, Clara, so I understand.
Yes. New life from the young. Eh, Father?
Yes, I am properly grateful. But what about the portrait?
Postponed.
Indefinitely.
What was it like? Player thought it was his best work.
It was not good, Father. Rather horrible, in fact.
It was impertinent. The man was a maniac.
Well, I wish I'd seen it.
No one will see it now, thank goodness. It was a moving message, Father, from Her Majesty, and people have been crying in the street.
Everyone's been absolutely marvellous.
I suppose he made me look as old and evil as he possibly could.
I see no need to worry about it at all.
Mr. Player will never paint another picture.
Not with his arms strapped behind his back, he won't.
Bullshit, that man.
Definitely, sir. We were always anxious about someone like that.
He won't trouble us again.
We always win in the end.
Please, don't tire yourself, Father. Just rest when you can.
An icky little sleepy.